Good morning, St. John. This is the day that the Lord has made. We've come to rejoice and be glad. And come on, let's put our hands together and give God some praise for another Sunday morning, another chance to gather in His house. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord, for I will enter His gates with thanksgiving and enter His courts with praise. I'll be thankful unto Him and bless His holy name, for the Lord our God is good. Oh, that's a call and response. Let me try it again. The Lord our God is good and worthy of all our praise. Oh, if you've got a reason to praise God on this Sunday morning, won't you just put your hands together, open up your mouth, and give God your best praise. Our God is worthy. Let's stand all over the room. Our God is worthy of our praise. And we've come today to lift up His name, to give Him the glory, to magnify the Lord just for who He's been in our lives. Let's bow together in a word of prayer. And as I pray from the pulpit today, I want you to bring to the forefront of your mind all of the things you're asking God for in this season, the prayers that are on your heart, the concerns that are in your mind, the situations that you're trying to figure out how to work through. Bring it to the front of your mind, because we believe that God does hear and answer our prayers. And before we pray, we're going to do something special today. Before we pray from the pulpit, I want you right in your seat, right where you are, if you're sharing online, to just begin to pray to God for yourself, to offer up your own prayer to God. We thank God that we can talk to Him and that He hears and answers our prayers. So begin to fill this place with the prayers of the righteous, because we know they do avail much. Asking God for healing, asking God for deliverance, asking God to open doors that no man can shut, asking God to break some chains, asking God to remove some spirits, to take away bondage and baggage, to release us to become who He's created us to be, because we know that He can and He will do it. And if we ask Him to, He'll answer our prayer and honor our requests. Reverend Montaigne, won't you come this morning and lead us to God's throne of grace?
Praise the Lord. Will you bow your hearts and bring your faith with my faith? Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, what a beautiful day that you have given us. We will never see this day again, but Lord, we want to take time out to say thank you. 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 That our name was on the get up list. Thank you, Jesus. That our last night's sleep was not in death. Or it has already been introduced by our pastor, but God, we still want to say thank you for your loving kindness. You didn't have to do it, God, but we're so grateful that you did. Your mercy and your love is from everlasting into everlasting. And we thank you, Lord, that it came right here this morning at the St. John O. Butler High Street. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that you're healing and you're mending hearts right now. The spirit of salvation is here, and Lord, we are willing and we are able. We want to receive it right now. Restoration is here, God. Restoration is here, God. Restoring our soul back to where it's supposed to be. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And we thank you that the healing process is on the way. We believe that all things are possible with you. And Lord, for us that don't have just a little bit of belief, help our unbelief, that you can move supernaturally and you can bring it to pass. I know that you can, and I know that you're able, and I know that you will. We love you, we need you, we adore you, and we can't do anything without you. Again, Lord, thank you that we were on the wake-up list. So many have gone on, loved ones and all like that, but God, here we are in the house worshiping you for a brand new day. Brand new mercies each and every day. Lord, we thank you. We can't get enough of saying thank you. If we had 10,000 tongues, we still wouldn't be enough. For more than 2,000 years, Lord, you gave us that power to say thank you. So I'll end this prayer after I said, let the power come on the choir, let the power come on the pastor, and we say thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. You don't know how good it feels to be in the front. Thank you.
He's a way maker, miracle worker, heart fixer. Has anybody here today got a testimony that God's been a way maker for you? And we worship you. We worship you. Before you go to your seats, I need you to look at your neighbor. And if you have not yet had a chance to introduce yourself to the person sitting to your left or your right, I need you to introduce yourself. Make sure they know at least your first name. It's a terrible thing to sit next to somebody in church and not even know their first name. So now that you've introduced yourself to them, I need you to look at them, call them by their first name and say, neighbor, I don't know what you came to do today, but I came to praise the Lord. If they didn't erupt in a praise right there, turn to your other neighbor and say, neighbor, I don't know what you came to do today, but I came to praise the Lord, because the Lord is worthy of all our praise. Oh, if you know that we serve a worthy God, I need you to put your hands together right there and give God your best praise, because the Lord is worthy.
Faithful,
Lord, you're faithful,
and we give you
and we give you
your Thank you.
do not pass me by. Musicians, pick that back up, that chorus. Pick that chorus back up. We can't let that go. I need all the old choir members in the congregation to stand for a second. We're going to have a little congregational rehearsal this morning. Where are the sopranos at? All the sopranos, make some noise. Sopranos, I need you to give the congregation their note. Because we're going to have a big church choir today. On that do not, come on, sopranos. Sopranos, join them in the congregation. Join them, do not. Y'all sound good. Come on, give the sopranos a hand. Now where are all my altos at? All the altos, make some noise. Make some noise, altos. Altos, come on, give them that note. Come on, altos, join them. Now where are all my tenors at? All the tenors and bass, make some noise. Come on, tenors, give the brothers and the sisters their note. Join them in, tenors and bass. I hear you, deacons. Come on, give the tenors a hand. Now we're gonna put it all together. So I need you, if you know, you can sing a little bit. Go ahead, stand on your feet. Stand on your feet. You sang in the shower this morning. You sang in the car on the way to church. Come on, make that joyful noise in the house of the Lord today. So musicians, I need you to bring us in. Deshae, I need you to tell her you got to hurt the whole church this time. Come on down here, Deshae. Come on down, come on down. We let an alpha on the pulpit. You got to wreck the whole church today. Can sing that good, but we come to make a joyful noise to the Lord, and we thank God for the chance to sing praises to God, because this is the key right here, because we have something to praise Him for. So we thank God that we get to sing praises to Him, because He's been too good for us to be silent. As the old preachers would say, just when I start thinking of the goodness of Jesus and all that He's done for me, my soul just starts crying out, hallelujah. I thank the Lord for saving me. And so we thank God that we've got a reason to praise Him, a reason to celebrate, a reason to have a smile on our face. With all the hell that we go through, we thank God that we still have a reason to smile. Just look at the person next to you and just smile at them. Just smile at them. We have a reason to smile, a reason to be happy, and a reason to give God praise. And we thank God for our music ministry that each and every Sunday takes seriously their responsibility to lead us into the presence of the Lord. And we thank God for them. Come on, let's thank God for our music ministry. If you're here today and you say, well, I didn't know I could sing in church, but I sounded good today. Come on out to choir rehearsal next Wednesday. Next Wednesday at 7 o'clock right in this room. We would love to have you as a part of our choir here at St. John, because we are a church that loves singing praise to God. So this will be a great place. If you love singing praise, we got a place for you. Amen. So we look forward to what God is doing and all that he has in store. We're going to prepare in a moment to bring our offerings, our gifts of love to the kingdom. God has been good to us, and we come to sow our seeds, to bring our tithes, our offerings, our gifts of love, our sacrificial gifts for all that God has done. We've been sharing throughout the first quarter and seeing how God has been blessing our church. He's been doing some amazing things in the area of our finances and our giving. And one of the things that we learn, and many of us have learned in our lives, is that whenever God wants you to do more for him, he'll give you more. If you want God to give you more, don't ask for more money. Don't sit up every night before you go to bed on the side of the bed and say, Lord, I need more money. Stop praying and say, Lord, I want to do more for the kingdom. I want to give more. I want to help people more. I want to be able to sow into projects that God has placed on the hearts of leaders. Ask God to allow you to do more for him, because God will always open up opportunities for you to be a blessing to someone else. One of the things I love about how God has been moving in many of our lives is that as we've been giving to the kingdom, he's opening up new things for us to do as a church. Looking at how we can begin to do more for our children and youth. In case you didn't know, the world won't save our children. If you're waiting for a school system, if you're waiting for a community program to save your children, you might as well give up that fight now. But it's our responsibility as the people of faith to build up opportunities for our children and youth to grow, to become strong believers of Jesus Christ. You may be great on the basketball court. You may be dynamic on the football field. You may can spike the ball over the net, but only knowing Jesus will get you into heaven. So over the coming weeks and months, we'll be looking at how we can build up more opportunities throughout the summer with Vacation Bible School and other activities to help our children begin to understand who Jesus Christ is in their lives. And we're able to sow and look at these opportunities because of the giving that you do each and every week. And so on behalf of your pastor, our leaders, our trustees, our officers, we thank you for being generous in your giving and trusting God and sowing into his soil, knowing that God will surely do amazing things in this place. So after you secure your offering, let's stand all over the room. Our ushers are going to move amongst us to receive our gifts. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we thank you today that you have blessed us with something to give. We ask now, O God, that you might use these offerings for the upbuilding of your kingdom here on earth. In Jesus' name, amen. Ushers, won't you come and receive the gift of the people of God? Don't forget, next week we launch our Bible study, Grounded, Anchoring Your Faith in 5 Foundational Principles. Many different opportunities to grow. If you want to grow in the comfort of your home on Tuesday at 7 o'clock, you can go right to our YouTube page beginning next week and log in right at 7 o'clock and share in Bible study online. Or if you would like to come out to the building, we have classes for you for all of our young adults. On Mondays at 6:30, we'll be gathering right across the street in our historic sanctuary. On Wednesday at 12 noon, for all of our seniors and anyone else who's free in the middle of the day, come on out for fellowship and growth together. And then on Thursday night at 6:30 and Saturday at 10 a.m. So many different opportunities to grow. We have persons who've been registering, and you can register for class even today. There's no charge. You don't have to be a member of the church. We just want to prepare accordingly for our in-person classes. So make sure you go to our website, the sjbc.churchcenter.com, and click right there on the top tab where you see the Grounded logo, and you can sign up for any class. But we are looking forward to becoming stronger believers in Jesus Christ, knowing that when we have our faith anchored in the Lord, there's no storm that can get us off track. Amen, somebody. I gotta say that again. When our faith is anchored in Jesus Christ, and it's not just lip service, but we really know what we believe, there's nothing the devil can do to get us off track. So we look forward to these 5 weeks of study sessions on learning about your salvation, learning about prayer, learning about forgiveness, learning about victory, learning about guidance, scriptures that will accompany each one to help us to grow. And so we look forward to that journey. So register today right on our website, and our classes will begin next week, starting next Monday for our young adults. And don't forget, this Friday we're heading down to Main Event in Suwanee. You can get your tickets there. We have a few tickets remaining that are free of charge right on our church center site, so make sure you check it out, the sjbc.churchcenter.com. Going down to Main Event, gonna have a good time in Jesus' name. As we shared last Sunday, it's a terrible thing to not be able to have fun. So I gave an assignment last week. We'll see what we do. How many people know you like to have fun? Raise your hand high. Okay, so we got more hands up this week. Last week I told you, if the person next to you didn't raise their hand, don't sit next to them this week. It looked like we sat next to people who like to have fun. And so Christians gotta have fun. Somebody should have shouted on that. Let me say that again. Christians have to have fun. You can't have the joy of the Lord and always be sad. Do you really think Jesus died for you to be sad? I'm gonna push it. Do you think he got up from the grave for you not to enjoy life? I would hate to stand before him and he look at us and say, "You've accepted me, so I'm gonna say well done." But you missed out on so much fun because you thought being a Christian meant you had to be serious. You know, many of us grew up in church, and you would see Christians, you see leaders who sit on the front row of church and just look serious. Something funny would happen and they just look serious. Well, yeah, I thank God that that day is gone. We can have fun in church. So we're going to have fun on Friday night down at Main Event. So make sure you register, sign up, get your tickets today. And don't forget, our memory verse for this month is Hebrews 11, verse 1. Anybody memorize it yet? Start off, now faith is. Oh, we got a good little distance in 1 week. Come on, give yourselves a hand. So this month, Hebrews 11, verse 1, memorize it. If you have a Bible app, I encourage you to save it, make an image of it, so you look at it as frequently as you can, because faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And this is a season where we're going to be walking by faith, because this, and I'll share this, and then we'll get ready for the word. You have no clue what God has in store for you. I need to speak that into somebody's life. You have no idea what God has in store for you. And the only thing you need to get it is faith. All you need to get what God has for you is to believe that God can do it. So this season, we walking by faith and not by sight. Sermon today, as we continue through this Eastertide season, we're going to begin a journey looking at two disciples and their unique path on the Emmaus Road. Scripture today is coming from the book of Luke, chapter 24, beginning with verse 13, as we continue to walk in the afterglow of the resurrection, because the tomb is still speaking to us even today. And we thank God that the stone was rolled away and there was no body there, because Jesus did indeed get up. Come on, give God praise that Jesus got up. Our choir is going to come and prepare us to hear from heaven this morning. And then we're going to go right to the word. looking at the journey on the Emmaus Road.
Thank you.
You are the source of my strength. You are the strength of my life. It's all right to praise him right there. Our music ministry and worship arts teams. And in the middle of our rehearsal, our session, our talk, the Spirit just showed up. And one of the things I shared with some of our leaders, we didn't get to rehearse like we had planned on Wednesday because the Spirit showed up. Whenever the Spirit shows up, your plans change. And I said to one of our leaders, I'm not worried about Sunday. Because if God would show up like this on Wednesday, I can't wait to see what he's gonna do on Sunday. And today, we've been blessed because our music ministry has brought seriously their responsibility. But not only that, they evidence that they don't just sing for performance. They sing because they believe what they say. And again, we thank God for them, for the anointing that makes preaching easy. And the pastor says, thank you. So thank you. Come on, put your hands together one more time for our music ministry. Book of Luke, chapter 24, beginning with verse 13. Let's stand all together. I'm going to read a large block of scripture today. I pray that God will speak through his word. Book of Luke, chapter 24, beginning with verse 13, we find these words. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleophas, asked him, "Are you the one visiting Jerusalem, or the only one visiting Jerusalem, that does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth." They replied, "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued as if they were going further. But they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within?' While he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us." Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we thank you for the songs of Zion that have been lifted, for the prayers of faith that have gone forward. Now, Lord, we turn to hear a word from you. I have studied, but I need your strength. I have prepared, but I need your power. I'm willing and I want to, but only you can make me able. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. And the people of God said, amen. Before you take your seat, I need you to just look at your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, don't miss Jesus." You may go to your seats all over the sanctuary. That's what I want to talk about today as we begin this series, this journey on the Emmaus Road, looking at this account from Luke revealing Christ on the Emmaus Road. In this first installment, I simply just want to pose that statement: don't miss Jesus. Don't miss Jesus. One of the foundational tenets of my life, my brothers and my sisters, is a belief and a fact that God will always be with me. No matter what I face, no matter what I'm going through, I stand on the truth that God will never leave my side. And wherever I find myself, I try to be confident that God can always come there to get me. When storms are raging, I come back to that truth. When things get difficult, I reflect on that understanding that he promised never to leave me. Never to leave me alone. And the truth of the matter is, many of us know that when we reflect on the things that we've done in our lives, when we look back down where we've come from, we can say that no matter where I was, God was there too. Even when I was not always in church, God was still with me. Even when it did not cross my mind to get up at 9:30 on a Sunday morning to sit in somebody's church and look like I was attentive, God was right by my side. Even when I made my bed in the pits of hell, God still said, I'm right here. And even though you're not looking for me, I'm still going to be found. And all you have to do is ask me to show up, and I'll always be right there. Oh, is there anybody here who has your own personal testimony that God has always been by your side? Even when you turned your back on him, he did not leave you. Even when you did not ask him to show up, he was always right there. Even when you tried to run away, he ran right beside you. You tried to outrun him. He said, you can't get away from me. Where can you go out of my presence? If you go to the mountaintops, I'm there. If you go to the valley low, I'm there. Because I'm always by your side. I know it's early in the sermon, but slap five with your neighbor and say, God's always with me. In fact, I feel him with me right now. God's always by our side. No matter what we face, God is always right there. We celebrate that God's always there. We shout that wherever we go, he's right with us. But if we could take off our sanctified holiness for a second, many of us can admit and declare that in spite of knowing that and have lived it and having the testimony and the t-shirt to prove it, there are times we felt all alone. We don't like to talk about it much because we think that it's going to make people look at us funny. But the reality is, when life really gets hard, sometimes it's difficult to find Jesus. We may know he's there, but it feels like he said, I'll be right back. Anybody ever been there? Going through a situation and you said, I know God's supposed to be with me, but God, where are you right now? I thought you was with me, but why did the doctors give me this report? I thought you were with me, but why did my children have to go through that storm? I thought you were with me, but why are these things happening to me? And the reality is, the longer you live, the more you will be pushed into corners where you question, is God still here? Even the most sanctified of us have asked that question. Say, Lord, why am I going through this? This should only happen to people who don't know you. Stay there for a second. I should not feel like I'm walking in the valley all alone. I've had great mountaintops, but why did I go down low? And one of the tricks of the adversary is to really make you think that the way God shows up in good times has to be the way he shows up in the bad. But the reality is, sometimes you got to look for him in a different way. And if you're not careful, you'll find yourself sitting on the side of the bed saying, I feel like I'm all by myself. Anybody ever felt that way? Felt like you were all alone? You may have been in a room full of people, but you felt like it was just you, yourself, and I. And you were looking for when help was coming your way. And I believe, my brothers and my sisters, that one of the best ways to describe the way the disciples felt after the crucifixion is by saying they felt alone. Jesus, their Savior, their Lord, the one who changed their lives, was gone. He was with them Thursday, had dinner with them, taught them some more lessons. He was with them even on Friday morning. He was drugged from judgment hall to judgment hall. People lied on him, spat on him, talked about him, but he was with them. He even talked to them from the cross. But when he died on that cross, took his body down, put it in a borrowed tomb, everything, hear this, became real. And one of the mysterious things about life is you can see where something is going, but it doesn't become real until it happens. I've walked with families who have loved ones who have been given a terminal date. Watched as illness has ravaged their body. You know that there's not much time left. But the moment they take their last breath, sometimes it's as if they did not see it coming. Families who have watched loved ones walk slowly down the Chili Jordan. But then when the end comes, they say, what do we do now? Disciples, they knew this was coming. They watched it Thursday night, all day Friday. But once he was buried, they said, we left alone. We don't have Jesus with us no more. The one who dried all our tears. The one who gave us hope in a hopeless world. The one who supplied all our needs. The one who let us know that everything would be all right. He's gone. And we have to figure out what we gonna do now. Luke records that these two disciples, two followers, Cleopas and one other, have made a decision. Jesus is dead. He's been dead 3 days. They say it's time to go back home. Ain't nothing else we can do here. We don't have resurrection power. Somebody missed that. We know when people die, we say goodbye. We don't touch them and expect something to happen. They know that if we stay in Jerusalem, it's not safe. The Passover feast is over. The festival's done. Everybody's going back home. And these two disciples make up in their mind, it's time for us to go home too. They begin the 7-mile journey down the Emmaus Road, saying we got to go back to figure out how do we pick up the pieces and keep on living. If we stay here, we're going to go crazy. Somebody missed that. If we stay at the scene of the crime, we're going to lose our minds. And one of the worst things you can ever do is stay put when everything falls apart. It's like, and this is not a St. John story, but if it is, then you just keep it to yourself. It's like when couples break up and live in the same house. Push it a step further. When they say we're not going to stay together, but still sleep in the same bed. Somebody going to go crazy. Might just caught that. And they say, no, we got to get out of here. Because if we stay here, we're not going to make it. And one of the things we have to do, my brothers and my sisters, is that whenever life gets too hard and things fall apart, we got to get moving. Don't stay in the pit of your despair and expect to still be sane. You have to value, hear this, your own mental health. One of my colleagues, I would always say, whenever her life got too crazy, she would get in the car and go drive through the mountains of West Virginia and Maryland and Pennsylvania, because she said, I just gotta change where I am. Because if I stay here, I'm gonna lose it. And if we could be honest, many of us know we have been close to losing it. Look at your neighbor and say, don't lie. As Grandmaster Flash said, don't push me, because I'm close to the edge. I'm trying not to lose my head, because I'm so close that if you just push me a little bit, you say hello, but you look at me crazy. You don't call me back when I asked you to call me right away. You don't bring that stuff home from the market. I might just lose it all. These two disciples said, no, we got to go, because if we stay here, we're going to go crazy. Life is too hard to watch your Savior die and stay for the repast. It's too much. We watched him suffer. He was innocent and he still died. He lived right and they still came for him. He was the one I tried to be like and he still found this fate. And if I stay here, I'm going to lose it all. So these two brothers, these two disciples, we don't know who the other is. It's Cleopas. Some believe that it's likely his wife. His wife was at the tomb, was at the grave, was at the tomb and at the cross. She was there. We don't know who. Oftentimes, scholars did not record the details of the women. And so we can project that perhaps his wife is with him. Because why would he go home without her? We project. We don't know for sure, but we project. And they're walking away and they say, we got to get out of here. And as they're walking, they're talking about what happened. Because you know, whenever you go through something, we like to talk about it. That's why you have a meeting, and then after the meeting, you call somebody to talk about the meeting. And then the next day, you say, y'all remember that meeting? Because we like to talk about what's happened. And so they're talking about it, and as they're talking on the road, 7 miles, taking roughly 2 hours to walk by foot, somebody shows up. It's a man. They don't recognize him. But it's Jesus. Oh, if I was a better preacher, somebody might have shouted right there. Let me say that again. They're walking. They don't recognize the man, but it's Jesus. Because I'm so glad that Jesus always just shows up. I think somebody ought to give God praise that Jesus shows up. Jesus shows up and he says, what y'all talking about? And they look at him and say, who in the world is this dude? Are you literally the only person who does not know what's been going on? If it was in 2024, we say, do you not follow any of the news stations on Instagram? Have you not checked Twitter? Have you not been looking at the news the last two nights that you don't know what's happening? She says, what's going on? They say, well, Jesus of Nazareth, he's a great man. Did great things. He was killed. We didn't think it was going to happen this way. We're upset at it, but we're leaving town to figure out what we're going to do now. Jesus looks at him, and I believe if you could put some pieces to his personality, probably rolled his eyes at him and said, come on, y'all. Y'all really think enemy was going to win? See, so often we look at Jesus as he's just floating around like we see on TV. You know, this great figure that gracefully walks everywhere and says, peace unto you. But Jesus walking, look at the text. He says, how foolish you are. Y'all really think that the devil could win this? I hadn't even planned to stay here, but we got to stay here for a second. Jesus dropped in and said, y'all missing something. You are elevating the devil to a place that he does not have power to live. And so often in our lives, we put the devil on a perch that he has not earned. We allow his attacks to live on as if, hear this, they are successful. You take the words people say about you and start believing it. Well, they said I was no good. I know I'm good. Somebody missed that. Well, they say I don't treat people right. I know I treat people right. They say I ain't show up right for this activity. I know I show up for folk. I'm not going to put the devil in a place that he did not earn, nor does he have the power to be. And Jesus looks at him and says, y'all got it wrong. This, you miss something. Let me show you how this worked. The Bible proceeds to say that he broke down the scriptures for them and helped them to understand. But something interesting happens here. So often we look at this text and you hear it shared in so ways, and we always say, how did they miss Jesus on the journey? But I want to change the lens we look through today and argue for the duration of this sermon to ask this question. How bad was life that they couldn't see him? What was happening in their minds that they missed him? Because so often we want to look at things as if it's black and white, when the reality is we live our lives in gray. I would love if everything in life was black and white, because then there would always be a right and a wrong. But the reality is there are very few things that are cut and dry like that. And we have to live our lives in places where sometimes, hear this, we miss Jesus too. I believe we are the disciples. We are these believers. We're the followers of Christ. And if we could be honest, many of us are missing Jesus right now because life is hard. If you know life is hard, just wave at me. Oftentimes, we portray that we have it all together. We come to church with a big church smile. We carry a big old Bible. We wear a vampire killing cross. We make it look like we have it all together. We uphold images for our friendship circles. We allow family to put weight on us to say that we have to keep it all together. We walk around as if we don't get the luxury to go through struggle, because there are too many demands on us to keep it all right. We do this, but the reality is the weight and the burdens of life will cause us to miss Jesus. Life can get so hard that you can't see the bright side anywhere. You can be walking around on the best day of the year and feel like the moon is up and clouds are over your life, because life will weigh you down. And this is the key, if I could push it. And life will cause us to create systems and chaos that keeps Jesus out. You call it coping. Well, you know, I got to get my little something. I got to smoke my little cigarette. It's going to kill you, but you know I need it. You know, I got to get my little drink every night. Well, the doctor said your liver is about to kill you. Well, you know, I just need it because I can't sleep without it. I got to go over her house. It's life. You know you don't need to go over her house. Well, you know, she just knows what I need. She can help calm me down. The reality is we create systems that block us, hear this, from seeing Jesus. And I'm preaching this today because in the aftermath of Easter, many of us have missed Jesus. We've walked this journey, our own personal Emmaus road, and the Lord was there, but we didn't see him. He was right by our side, but we didn't recognize him because life was too heavy for us to see him right there. And if we're going to grow to become who God has created us to become stronger Christians, we have to learn to find him. See, I'm not just preaching this just because it's after Easter. I'm preaching this because in order for us to take the next step on our own personal Christian journeys, we have to learn to find Jesus in everything. And we cannot be naive to think that it will happen on its own. One of the things that new believers often get faced with is they get hit with a reality that everything's not going to be good. And many new believers, they'll join the church, they'll be happy, they'll get on every ministry, they'll sign up for every event until life hits them. And then you say, where they go? They used to come to church all the time. Now they don't come at all. Because they did not understand that you have to constantly look for them. And I'm preaching today to folk who know that if we're going to grow, we got to keep on looking for Jesus. Never get so comfortable in your level of spirituality or where you think you are on your Christian journey that you think you ain't got to look for him anymore. But you have to look every day and say, where's Jesus in this? Where's the Lord with me right now? It's tough, but I'm looking for him. I don't know how I'm going to make it, but I'm going to keep on looking till I see Jesus. And when I see him, I'm going to know what to do. We got to keep on looking for Jesus. Well, let me throw another monkey wrench in there, because a sermon is an argument of a point. Because the Bible does not just say they don't recognize him. The Bible says in verse 16 that they were kept from recognizing. I gotta admit that I had some problems with that. Because not only were they not looking for him, not only did they not recognize him, they were also kept from recognizing him. And as I studied this and pushed it, I wondered if maybe, just maybe, sometimes Jesus blocks himself from us. Hear this. Because we aren't looking for him. One of the worst things you can ever do is give yourself to someone who ain't looking for it. You want to feel lower than a footprint? Show up at the house of a friend or a person you think is going to be something more when they weren't expecting you. Try to help somebody. You better call before you go. Again, that's another sermon. But Jesus says, y'all not looking for me. And because you aren't looking for me, I'm not going to reveal myself to you, because you won't know how to receive it. You won't know what to make of me showing up, because you aren't looking for me. And I believe in this season where God is calling us, God wants us to say, no matter what we're going through, we're going to look for Jesus. No matter how bad things get on the job, we're going to look for Jesus. We're not going to look for a battle. We're not going to look for a person. We're not going to look for a scheme. We're not going to look for somebody to wallow in our sadness. But wherever we are, we're saying, Lord, I'm looking for you. And I'm not moving till I find you. Now, we got to look for him in everything. And in order to find him, what I've learned, my brothers and my sisters, we have to cultivate an understanding that we must block out the noise. Somebody say, block out the noise. The disciples are journeying and they're talking about what has happened. Their talk is, did y'all see what they did to Jesus? You see how all those folk who was with us on Sunday ran? You see how some of them disciples ain't even show up to the cross? You hear the rumor that Peter was out here and denied him 3 times and then started crying like a baby? It's the Bible. Have you seen the 11? I don't even know where they are. I heard Judas dead. Who you think got to him? Because remember, we have the benefit of knowing the facts. But we live in a world where we don't always have them. And we always fill in the facts with what we think. Amen, somebody. I believe they may walk and say, you think Peter got the Judas? You know, he cut the ear off of that centurion. You know, Peter fly off the handle. Maybe he got to Judas real quick. And nobody saw it, so that's why they say nothing. Maybe that's why Peter locked up in the room. Because he's not just scared that they're going to get him for following Jesus. Maybe he took Judas out. You know how we feel in the story. They talking about all this stuff. But the one thing they aren't talking about is Jesus. They're talking about all the details, but they miss the central figure. And how often in our lives do we spend time on the fringes and miss what's really important? These believers, they walk in and the noise has gotten them to be confused, gotten them to run away and think that nothing good can come of this. But Jesus shows up and he's teaching us, if you gonna find me, you gotta stop filling your mind with the noise. In sports, whenever, especially in basketball, when the away team has the ball, the crowd gets loud. If you go to a game, you'll see when an opposing team's player is shooting a free throw, they'll put signs up that say, make some noise. Because they know that if we make enough noise, we'll distract him or her and hope that they miss the shot. And oftentimes in clutch games, the star players will come down the line, get fouled, and have to go to the free throw line. And they'll stand at the free throw line and they will make the shots. After the game, the question will be asked, how did you focus? How were you able to do this with all of the noise? And the star players, the best players, those at the top of their game, will often say, well, I play better on the road. Hear this. Because the noise causes me to focus more. And what I've learned, my brothers and my sisters, is that whenever the enemy is sending noise, that's your cue to focus harder. Because if you can focus in the midst of the noise, you not only defeat the attack of the enemy, you see what God is doing around you. And there's somebody here who's been going through some stuff. You've been trying to figure out how you're going to make it. God told me to tell you, block out the noise. Put on some earmuffs. Put on some blinders. And just march straight ahead and let God show you how he's going to bless you in the midst of it. Now they so focused on everything else that they miss, they should be focused on Jesus. Because whenever you focus on Jesus, everything works out. Sister Dickie, if I was a better preacher, somebody would have ran right there. Let me try it again. Whenever you put Jesus at the center and you say, I'm going to focus on him, I don't care what's over here. I ain't worried about what's over here. I'm not getting involved in what's over here, but I'm fixing my eyes on the author and the finisher of my faith. And as long as my eyes are on him, he's gonna work everything out for me. Oh, slap fire with your neighbor and say it's time to focus on Jesus. Block out the crowd, mute the noise, and keep your eyes on him. No, he said, if we're not going to miss Jesus, we got to focus on him. Because if you focus on him, you're going to find him. See, I'll shout on that myself. He does not hide himself from us. But as long as we look for him, he won't always show up. They said, no, y'all got to learn. If you don't want to miss Jesus, you got to focus on him. Block out the noise. But then also, and I love what he does in the text, he also then walks them through the word of God. And he reveals to them the foretelling of his resurrection in scripture. And if we're going to learn to find Jesus in everything, we have to learn to rightly divide the word of God. One of the greatest tragedies of this generation is that we have lost our biblical literacy. The Bonner Group put out a study about 15 years ago now saying that this was the most illiterate biblical generation that we've ever seen in our nation. People say, how'd that happen? People stopped coming to church. People stopped taking their children to vacation Bible school. They say, well, you don't need to come early for Sunday school. Just come sit in the worship, but then just come sit home. They stopped reading their Bibles in the house. They took prayer out of school. Now, I ain't getting on what you believe is right and wrong. I'm just telling you the data. We've become an illiterate generation in understanding God's word. And as a result, we don't know where he is. Because the Bible gives us a couple of things. It is God's word. It is God's word that's given to his people. But then it is also a revelation of what he's done to give us a clue of what he's going to do. Because he said, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. So if you understood how I showed up 6,000 years ago, you have a clue for how I'm going to show up for you. But when you don't know how to divide it, you can't find the clue. It's as if you're putting together a puzzle and the instructions are in another language you don't speak. I help you with this. It's as if you bought some furniture off the internet. I don't even need to give any more details if you haven't done that. You sitting there scratching your head saying, I don't know where this piece go. It's saying I need this piece, but I don't have it. But I got five of this other piece that's not even in the instructions. Because the word of God gives us an understanding of how to find them. And the tragedy of the text is not just that they didn't see his physical appearance. It's that they did not believe that he was going to get up from the dead. And Jesus says, if you want to find me, just open the word. Somebody missed that. I got to say it again. If you're looking for me, open my word. Because when you open my word, I'm there on every page. And this the shout here. And as long as you stay in my word, you'll keep finding me. Jesus said, if you remain in me and my word in you, you can ask whatever you wish. And it's going to be given to you. Because when you're in my word, you're connected to me. So that whenever you pull on that connection, I'm guaranteed to show up. Hear this. Because my word can never return to me void. If I said it, it is yea and amen. And this the dance in it. This the dance in it. And when you read my word, you'll see over 6,000 promises. So that if you're not sure if you're going to make it through this, you can just rest on what I already said. And what I already said will give you what you need to press on through. That's why it's so important in this season to be in Bible study. Amen, lights. We're not doing Bible study just to check a box. No, we're having Bible studies at multiple times so that we can find the Lord. Because if we're not careful, we will find ourselves in storms with no GPS. We will be in the midst of hell breaking out in our lives and not have a clue how to find Jesus when we need him. But when you get in his word, you know for sure that no matter what comes my way, God's going to be with me. Even when I'm walking through that valley in the shadow of death, I can fear no evil. Even when those weapons are formed up against me, I can stand confident that they shall not prosper. Even when the enemy comes at me like a flood, I can be still because God's going to raise up a standard against it. Even when all hell is breaking loose in my life, I can stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. So no matter what's coming my way, I know, bro, God told me he would take care of me. God promised he'd never leave me. God said in his word that he would show up. God said if I look to the hills from whence cometh my help, I can be confident that my help is coming from the Lord, who made heaven and earth, who will not suffer my foot to be moved. He that keepeth Israel is the same God that's going to keep me. Just like he kept them in the Bible days, he's going to keep me too. Just like he kept Moses, he's going to keep me. Just like he kept Joshua, he's going to keep me. Just like he kept David, he's going to keep me. Just like he kept Solomon, he's going to keep me. And just like he got Jesus up, he's going to get me up. So if I don't know what's going to happen, I'm going to keep on looking for where Jesus is. And sooner or later, I'm going to see him. And when I see him, I'm going to give him praise. When I see him, I'm going to celebrate. When I see him, I'm going to lift up hands and say, thank you, Lord. You didn't leave me. You didn't forsake me. I thought I was alone, but you showed up. And because you showed up, I've got a reason to give you praise. So no matter what you're going through, just keep on looking for Jesus. Block out all the noise. Tell yourself, I'm going to focus on Jesus so I can make it. Keep on reading the pages of your Bible. And last but not least, stay in community, because the great thing that happens in the text, Cleopas didn't go home by himself, but he had somebody by his side, and he didn't know it then, but one of the mysterious and miraculous things that happens when we're in community is that Jesus says that when two or three are gathered together in my name, I will be in the midst of them. So though they were scared, though they had questions, though they were unsure of what would come, they prepared themselves for Jesus to do what he said he would do. And if you're here and you feel alone, if you're here and you feel by yourself, God sent me to tell you to get up and get close to somebody else. Because when you're close, Jesus will show up, even when you don't know that he's coming. He will step right in, wrap his arm around you, and let you know that everything will be all right. Now I'm done. I'm finished my sermon. But I think there's somebody in St. John on a Sunday morning who needs to see what I'm talking about. I need you to grab your neighbor by the hand and say, neighbor, I'm going to stay with you until Jesus shows up. I'm going to stay on the journey until he walks right into my house, until he shows up on my job, until he touches my body. And I believe that he will, because he said it, and I believe it, and that settles it. So Jesus, I'm looking for you. Jesus, I'm searching for you. Jesus, come on in. Take a seat. Turn around my life. Turn around my family. Turn around my church. Jesus, come on in. Come on. Yes. Come on in, Jesus. We need you, Jesus. We're not doing it without you. But we're keeping our eyes until he shows up. And God just told me to tell somebody today, you've been looking and you've been waiting. Just keep on looking, because God is on the way in to your life. I'm looking for him. I ain't gonna miss them no more. I'm tired of feeling alone. I'm tired of doubting. I'm gonna get Jesus. I'm gonna pick it up some next week. I just gotta share this piece. They weren't looking for him, but he still stepped in. Somebody didn't catch it, I gotta say it again. They weren't looking for him, but he was there anyway. So no matter what you face, no matter what you go through, no matter how bad it might be right now, people may have turned their back on you. Situations may have flipped upside down. Your money may be laughing back at you. But Jesus is right there. Let's stand all over the room. God willing, we'll continue on this journey next Sunday. Unlocking the truths on the Emmaus Road. Because the Emmaus Road is all about seeing Jesus. If you can just see Jesus, everything will be all right. Said to the Apostle Paul, we want you to preach that we might see Jesus. Because if we see him, everything will be okay. You've been stressing about what you have to face. You've been trying to strategize your way out of a difficult place. You've been thinking that you could come up with the right plan to get through this. God says, stop trying to figure it out. Just find Jesus. Just fix your eyes on him. Just see him at work in everything around you. Because once you get clued in, you'll realize, I can make it. This may be hard for me, but it's not hard for him. This may seem like the biggest obstacle I've ever had to face, but it's not for him. I feel alone, loved ones gone, life been flipped and turned in ways I didn't expect. But the one who got up from the grave is waiting to grab you by the hand and walk you from your present misery into your glorious future. The thing that's bothering you today is just setting you up for the blessings of tomorrow. You just gotta find Jesus. And let him lead you into the world that he has already created for you. And there may be someone here today who's at a place in your walk where you need to find Jesus again. May have grown up in church, may have your name on the roll somewhere, but you need to get to a place where you say, Lord, I'm looking for you now. God has sent you this morning to this sanctuary, to our virtual campus, for you to hear a sermon, to be a part of a worship full of people saying, we're looking for Jesus. And you don't have to look by yourself. If that's you today, my brother, my sister, I want to extend to you an invitation, an opportunity to take a faith step, to say, Lord, I'm ready to get connected to you again. I'm ready to join a church to let the world know this is the place I'm growing. This is the place I'm getting plugged in. Because I don't want to miss Jesus as he moves in my life. If that's you today, my brother, my sister, I want you to take a step into the aisle. Come down here, give me your hand, give God your heart. Let this be your day. Let this be your moment. Let this be your chance where you say, I'm not getting lost anymore, but I'm walking into the future that God has for me. As every head is bowed, every eye closed. If you're here today, you don't have a church home, you don't have a place where you're growing in the word, I just want you to raise your hand this morning. I just want to pray for you. Nobody can see you, only God can help you. If you're here and you say, I don't have a place where I'm plugged in, I've been coming to St. John, but I'm a bootleg member. I've just been sitting in worship, but I've never fully given myself to the life of the church. If that's you today, just raise your hand. If you're sharing in the virtual sanctuary, just drop an emoji right in the chat. This is your day. This is your moment. This is your opportunity to get plugged in to God. God has more for your life. There's so much he wants to do. And a part of your future gets unlocked when you take a step of faith and say, I'm getting plugged in and reconnected to God's local church. It's in the context of community that God unlocks blessings in our lives. And I want you today, my brother, my sister, to don't block yourself off from receiving that blessing. But say to the Lord, Lord, I'm ready to receive everything that you have for me. Our Father, our God, I pray today for my brother, my sister, who shares with us in this room, who shares with us in the virtual sanctuary. I thank you that you allowed their path to connect with us today, allowed them to be a part of our worship. And I ask now, oh God, that you might move in their spirit. Give them the spiritual courage and comfort to take a step for you. Let them see that this is the time in their lives. This is their season, their moment to get reconnected to you and allow you to usher them into some great places. For Lord, we know you can do it because you've done it for us. And it's our prayer that you would do it for them too. In Jesus' name, amen. My brother, my sister, if that's you today, take that step of faith. Don't stand on the sidelines anymore, but say, Lord, I'm ready to put my all on you and be fully committed to what you're going to do. And if you're sharing with us in the virtual sanctuary today and you want to connect to us, I want you to go to our website, thesjbc.churchcenter.com. Click on Connect to St. John. We would love to welcome you into the life of the church because we believe that God is doing something new and we want you to be a part of it because he's Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Let's sing that all over the room. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Next Sunday, we continue looking at this journey. God is revealing himself to us and encouraging us to go look for him. I'd encourage you this week, as you study your scripture, Hebrews 11:1, to also spend some time in this 23rd chapter of Luke, asking God, 24th chapter of Luke, asking God to speak to you on your own personal Emmaus journey. Because there's a lesson to be learned after the resurrection. You don't get it all on Easter. Doesn't all hit you on that Sunday when he got up. Yeah. It's a journey. And you want to receive what he has because Pentecost is coming. Pentecost
is coming.
And when Pentecost comes, we want to be ready to receive the outpouring of His Spirit that will then prepare us for what God has next. So study through that this week. We're going to pray about it because God's getting ready to do some great things in our lives. Was anybody blessed in worship today? Thank you to all of our ministries, our ushers, our media team, our security ministry, our parking lot ministry, all those who serve, our greeters, our officers and leaders, and our music ministry, all those who work to make sure that we're able to give God praise each and every Sunday in an excellent way. We go home today and prepare ourselves for what God's going to do. We come out on Friday, have fun at Main Event, and get ready for Bible study, because we're going to learn to rightly divide the Word of God. The Lord bless you, and the Lord keep you. The Lord lift up the light of His countenance round about you, and the Lord give you peace. The Lord preserve your going out and your coming back in. And the Lord help you to see Jesus in everything that you go through. We've come today to worship, but we leave to let the light of Christ shine all around us. In the name of the one who died for our sins and got up on that Easter Sunday morning, Jesus the Christ, we all say amen. Give somebody a big hug as you leave today.